Well, hello everyone. Welcome to the program. My name is Reverend Brian, and I am the Right-Winged Reverend. Well, today's program is another in our ongoing series called American Preachers. And today's preacher that we're going to take a look at is one of my all-time favorites. His name is Josh McDowell, and we're going to take a look at him in detail in just a minute. But before we do that, let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are an awesome, awesome God. We want to give you thanks, praise, and glory, and honor for everything. Lord, I pray that the words that are spoken today are truthful and honest and blessing to those who hear, so they can in turn be a blessing to those around them. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you, and we do it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Josh McDowell, well, I was given a book many years ago, right after I got saved, called More Than a Carpenter. And it was written by a guy by the name of Josh McDowell. And that book, a little thin book, was, you know, 2 hours to read it. But what a great book. And I have used that and referred to that many, many times throughout my ministry. And so today we're going to take a look at that book and another one that he has done. But I want to tell you how I got here to do Josh McDowell, because originally when I made my list up of authors that I was going to take a look at, Josh McDowell was not on the list. I mean, technically he is not an American preacher. I mean, he is an American and he preaches, but he's not known as a preacher. His main ministry is as an apologetic and an author. But we're going to get into that in a minute. I want to start by telling a story. This past Christmas, I was at a friend's house celebrating the holidays. And he had given me a book. This was around Thanksgiving. He had given me a book to read. Now, he and I have never exchanged books, have never been that close. We have a couple of things in common. So when he gave me the book, I was a little taken back. And he didn't tell me anything about it. He just said, here, I want you to read this, and then we'll talk about it later. And I said, okay. So I took the book and read it, and it was about a brain surgeon who gets a very rare disease, goes into a coma for a week, comes back and tells an amazing story of going to heaven, meeting God, and then coming back. Now, this friend of mine is a doctor, and his family are all Catholics. Now, having been born and raised Catholic, I understand what that means. I understand what they believe. I understand how they believe. So it was interesting to me, the book that he gave me, and I prayed a lot about that. And I thought, well, why in the world is he giving me this particular book? Why didn't he give me a book on medicine? Or, I don't know, just, I mean, he knows that I'm a Christian preacher. He knows that. So I just prayed about it, and I thought, well, you know, if he's a man of science, he may very well just be being a searcher. Knowing that there's more than a relationship with Jesus than just than Catholicism. And he's feeling me out, trying to see where I'm at. So we went back for Christmas. And while we were there, I gave him the book back and we discussed it a little bit. We were all in the kitchen. His wife was cooking and he and I were chatting. And I told him offhandedly about a book called More Than a Carpenter. And his wife pipes up and says, oh yeah, I've read that book. Which I thought was interesting. But I went ahead and I told him the story of Josh McDowell, which I'm going to tell you in just a minute. The interesting thing about it was right after I told him the whole story of Josh McDowell, his only words to me was, "Yeah, but how do you know that the Bible is real?" And I thought, oh, that's what this is about. Okay, we want to test out. He wants me to explain to him why the Bible is accurate. He's a man of facts. He's a man of science. So he wants to understand the Bible. And in my mind, I made a mental note. And I said, okay. So we chatted for a little while. And I told him, I said, I have another book at home in my library by the same guy, Josh McDowell, and it's called More Evidence That Demands a Verdict. I'll bring it to you next time I come over. So I went right home, got the book, and set it by the door to take to him. And as it was sitting there, I wasn't for sure what the content is. I bought that book mostly as a reference book. It's not a book I sat down and read cover to cover. So I got the book out and I started looking at it, and we're going to talk about what I found when I looked in that book, and I'm very glad that I did, which is why we're doing this program. Because I was so impressed with the book, and then I did some research and found out he really is a preacher, and he has given a lot of talks throughout his career. So now that you understand how we got here, let's talk about Josh McDowell. Josh McDowell has been married 45 years to the same woman. Her name is Dottie. They have 4 children and 10 grandchildren. Now here is the story of Josh McDowell. He was born to a farmer. His dad was the town drunk. He was an abusive man, beat his mom senseless many times, and Josh, as he was growing up, vowed that one day when he got strong enough he would kill his dad. So they go through, Josh leads kind of a rough existence. His dad is known as the town drunk, and they're poor. So he has a rough upbringing. So he goes off to school and has troubles in school. But as he goes to college, he spends time going around college. Now he's going pre-law, okay? So we're not talking about somebody that's not smart at all. So as he's going around campus, he starts noticing, well, one of the characteristics that he has is every time he starts something, he gets bored. And by the way, I have noticed that tends to be a characteristic of most people who are not saved. They get interested in something, and they go in and do it, and then they get bored and move on to something else. Got a girl in my office who, first it was shoes, and then it was makeup, and then it was money, and then it was, I mean, there's always a different God to replace the other one because the last one doesn't satisfy them. That's what they mean when Christians talk about the God-sized hole in your soul. Nothing can fill it. They just haven't figured that out yet. So he's on campus, and he's gotten bored and changed his major and changed schools, and anyway, he's heading down a path, but he finally finds a school that he's okay with, and he sits in the common area, and he notices this group of kids that come in every day, and they're different than anybody else on campus. They have a genuine care for each other. They don't cuss or smoke or drink, and they seem extremely happy. They're very close and tight-knit. And as he sits back and watches them, he secretly wants what they have, but he doesn't understand what it is or how to get it. So he decides he's going to make friends with them. So one day he walks up to the group and introduces himself. And as he's talking, they make friends, And so about a week or two later, you know, I'm just going to read it straight from his words. It says, about 2 weeks later, I was sitting around a table in the student union talking with some members of this group. Soon the conversation got around to the topic of God. I was pretty insecure about the subject, so I put on my big front to cover it up. I leaned back in my chair acting as if I couldn't care less. Christianity, ha, I blustered. That's for weaklings, not intellectuals. Deep down, I really wanted what they had, but with my pride and my position in the university, I didn't want them to know that I wanted what they had. Then I turned to one of the girls in the group and said, tell me, what changed your lives? Okay, now, first off, he was elected to the student government there when he said his position in the college. So he turns to one of the girls and says, what changed your life? Why are you so different from the other students and the faculty? She looked me straight in the eye and said two words I had never expected to hear in an intellectual discussion on a university campus. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, I snapped. Don't give me that kind of garbage. I'm fed up with religion, the Bible, and the church. She quickly shot back, Mister, I didn't say religion. I said Jesus Christ. Taken aback by the girl's courage and conviction, I apologized for my attitude. But I'm sick and tired of religion and religious people, I added. I don't want anything to do with it. So there you have a picture of his position, how he's gotten to, he's about to make a life-changing decision that he doesn't even understand. But that was the beginning. Let me go on. Then my new friends issued me a challenge I couldn't believe. They challenged me, a pre-law student, to examine intellectually the claim that Jesus Christ is God's son. I thought this was a joke. These Christians were so dumb. How could something as flimsy as Christianity stand up to an intellectual examination? I scoffed at their challenge. Well, he may have scoffed, but what happens is, a couple of weeks later, it just keeps gnawing at him. And at the time, he doesn't understand it, but it's Jesus that is pulling at him. So he, again, makes a life-changing decision. He quits school, travels to Europe, and goes to all of the museums, all of the churches, everywhere that has any types of documents at all, and researches them exhaustively. Now, he does this for several months, and then he tells the story of one night he was in a hotel room and he hears a voice talk to him and says, Josh, you don't have a leg to stand on. Well, that threw him. And when he sat back and looked at all of the evidence, he realized, even as a pre-law student, that not only does Christianity stand up to an intellectual examination, he figures out that he may have been right about religion, but Jesus Christ is not religion. And I say that almost every time I talk about church. I do not push religion. I do not push church. I push Jesus Christ. There is a difference between a relationship and a church. There, just like there's a difference between a relationship and an institution called marriage. You can be married and not be married. So he figures this out. Then he gets saved, and now he is truly saved. And the interesting part of this whole story is that years later his dad is dying, Josh talks to him and says, you know, at one point I wanted to kill you, but I love you, Dad. And the dad breaks down, just breaks down, and comes back to Josh a couple of weeks later and says, how can you love me? And so he tells him about Jesus, and his dad ends up getting saved just before, and he dies a couple of weeks later. But that whole thing, and his dad got saved. What a blessing that is. So anyway, I can see, as you can tell, I really enjoy the story. I can see time slipping away. Now, More Than a Carpenter, I don't know if you could still buy that, but when I was buying them, I bought them in a six-pack, and they were, I don't know, 10 bucks for six books. They're just little thin paperback. And what I would do is I would pass them out instead of tracks. You know, if I thought people, a person was searching, I would give them this book and say, here, just read this. It's a fun little read. Take you a couple hours. See what you think. We'll come back and talk about it. And I did that for a lot of years. I think the last time I went to do it, I couldn't find it anywhere. But I think that was before my computer days. I haven't checked recently. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is the other book that Josh McDowell has done, and it's called The New Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Now, as I started the program, I told you about my doctor friend who I finally discovered was searching information about the Bible. So I got the book out and I started looking at it, and the very first chapter, this is how I know this is from God. The very first chapter is called The Uniqueness of the Bible. I mean, he covers many, many topics, and I'm going to read some of them to you. But it says The Case for the Bible, and it goes through it, and I read it. It's awesome. It tells about all the unique things about the Bible. You know, as an example, if you go back and look at any book ever written by man, 50, 100 years, even in textbooks, and you compare them with now, you will always find errors in the information covered because time, technology, information, knowledge changes over time. The more we know, the more we know that things we believed in the past were wrong. That has never happened to the Bible. There were times when people thought they had found errors in the Bible, but God always proves that's right. Here's an example. In Psalms, it talks about springs in the ocean. All the way up to the 1960s, the people would turn to the tell people, there's no springs in the ocean. Springs are fresh water, and the ocean is salt water. There can't be springs in the ocean. And they would use that as an error in the Bible. Fallible. Science catches up to the Bible. We now know that there are springs in the ocean. Scientists have proven that. So the inerrancy of the Bible is one of the greatest facts that you can ever have. Another one would be that it was written over a period of about 1,500 years. It was written by hundreds of different people and loosely put together in scrolls for most of that time. And written in three different languages. And yet, not one mistake in the Bible. That can only come from God. Now, I am going to give him this book and I'm going to let him. Now, let me read you some of the titles of the chapters in this book. How We Got the Bible. Is the New Testament historically reliable? Is the Old Testament historically reliable? Now this first section is all about the Bible. Part two is the case for Jesus. As an attorney, or pre-law at the time, he wanted to prove that Jesus was a man and not a God. And one of the lines that he comes up with, and I'm paraphrasing here, one of the lines that Josh McDowell comes up with in his defense of Jesus, he says, Jesus was either God or he deserved an Oscar award. Because if he wasn't God, it was what he was claiming was the equivalent to being a boiled egg. And here's another interesting thing that I learned about. With all of the things the Old Testament said about the coming of Jesus and all of the fulfilled scripture that Jesus did while he was on the earth to prove that he was God, and there was well over 100 fulfilled scriptures, and I don't remember the exact number, but the equivalent of one man being able to do that would be the equivalent of taking a silver dollar and painting it red. Okay? and then taking as many silver dollars as it would take and cover the entire state of Texas. You know, you put the coins end to end, side to side, cover the entire ground of Texas, knee deep. Okay, you got the picture? And then reaching down one time, reaching down into that stack, the size of the state of Texas, knee deep, and picking out the red silver dollar. That's the odds that one man could fulfill 100 of those, 100 plus, of the scriptures that are said to be fulfilled by Jesus and have been proven that he has fulfilled them, as Josh McDowell will tell in the book. Well, that covers pretty much all the time I've got. I could talk about Josh McDowell for a long time, but in conclusion, what I have to say about Josh McDowell as an American preacher, listen to him anytime you can. Read all of his books. You can find his official website on the internet. It is josh.org. He is an amazing preacher. He's an amazing evangelist and apologist for the Christian people, and an outstanding author. We rate our preachers from 0 to 5 Bibles. Josh McDowell gets a perfect 5 Bibles. And be on the lookout for his son, Sean, who is reaching out to young people also. He also is an author. So be on the lookout for Sean McDowell. Let's program, everyone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are an awesome, awesome God. We want to give you thanks and praise and glory. Lord, I pray that you would take the words of this program and use it as a blessing to those that hear it, so they in turn can be a blessing to those around them, and give them an opportunity to witness about Jesus to somebody in their life. And hopefully, what they learned from Josh McDowell will help them to do that. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you, and we do it all and pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, that's the program, everyone. You have a blessed week. Just a couple of announcements. If you'd like to know a little bit more about who we are and what we do, you can find us online at www.prayerboxministry.org. That's O-R-G.org. Also, all of our programs are now in podcast form. For all of you that are using smartphones and iPods, go over and check out our podcast and subscribe to us. All of our programs are on podcast over there. Go over and check us out. Let's program, everyone. You have a blessed week. I look forward to next week. My name is Reverend Brian, and I am the Right Wing Reverend.